Welcome to this short lecture where we will try to motivate or give you some insights why software architecture is a useful tool for software development. The question, why should we do architectural design, is often raised because you don't really see why it's needed, because many of the things you do, you will do anyway. However, it's important to have a complete understanding what could be done, because many times you could do much more with the structures, the questions, the evaluation analysis you perform at this level, in order to improve several aspects of a development project. So what we will try to do today is to show you some of the examples, but it's also important to remember that software architecture is useful not just in top-heavy, waterfall-like process models. It's something that can be used and should be used also in iterative incremental process models like Scrum or XP. I would say that any project of some scale can benefit from reasoning about software architecture during planning, during the design, but also as means of documentation. And sometimes you do things in a lot of detail, but as you will see, you can do some things rather quickly, and then spend more time on other aspects of your architecture. So software architecture, well, there are many benefits, but we try to summarize the planning and cost here as one of the more important contributions. And I've seen in previous lectures that the idea of decomposing, identifying subsystems, how the subsystems communicate, that turns a complex problem into some set of less complex problems, where each subsystem can be to some extent considered as independent. So from a planning and cost perspective, well, it's very important that we reach the agreement between the subsystems, and if we do that, well, we see a lot of benefits in terms of planning, because now we can plan each and every subsystem independently. We can also measure progress much more easily with this approach. Another aspect of planning is, of course, how much will it cost given this plan? So planning financial aspects, man hours, consultancy costs are much easily discussed if you have an idea of what the system is all about. And software architecture level, well, that is a good enough level for these discussions. We can also use it to allocate equipment. We can use it to map activities and process, etc. So software architecture provides managers and the staff involved in any project with a tool with system descriptions that they can use to better plan and also estimate the cost, and also do the follow-up during the course of a project. A second opportunity is that it enhances communication, and this is fairly obvious that we can come up with high level decompositions, we can hide the details behind interfaces, we split responsibilities up, and we talk a lot about what, not how, at first, and then altogether the architecture can be used as the means quickly introducing new staff, for instance, or communicating ideas to stakeholders in a project. A third use is reuse. And we can reuse knowledge, we can reuse assets in our projects, and the decomposition into subsystems provides a description of what we expect from subsystems, and if we can map these expectations to assets available on the market, it can be used as a selection tool. So we can select technologies, we can select services, we can select frameworks based on what we have outlined in our decompositions. We can also use the architecture level to focus more on knowledge reuse. Say, for instance, that we plan to use microservices, or we use a cloud native setup for our development. Well, then both these will impact how we should and will organize the architecture. And we also know, to some extent, the consequences of these decisions. So if we decide to go for microservices, for instance, we know that we will have to, or we should organize our development team in a certain way, and the architecture should match this organization. If we go for cloud native, well, then we have continuous integration, continuous deployment, and that means that we should come up with an architecture that suit that style of automated processes. And the fourth and final one is the obvious one, that we have already been looking into this, that the architectural level supports the strategic design decisions, the decisions you have to make up front before you can continue and work on parts of a system. So functionality is one of these aspects. You allocate responsibilities for functionality onto the system, but quality and the qualities are, well, security, performance, and the like, you have to make decisions about these also, because some of these decisions will have an effect on a majority of the components in your, or subsystems in your system. And there's no free lunches. There are no free lunches, as you know, and it means that you have to trade. You have to trade some attributes like performance for others. You have to reach an agreement, as I said, early during development. And it means that you need this level, this architectural level, to perform the analysis, to evaluate the design options, to see what happens when you combine your proposed security mechanism with the functionality. What is the what are the consequences? What is the effect of this? So architecture supports design. It provides the abstraction level for in-depth analysis, supporting reasoning and decision making. Okay, so that was four of the more important areas where software architecture contributes. However, there are many more, as you will find in the literature. So that was was all for this very short lecture, and I hope to see you soon again.